that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
God, we thank you for that. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your love, God, that is so deep that we can't even understand it. God, we thank you for your mercy, your forgiveness, God, your grace, God. We thank you for all that you are. And we just pray right now as we begin chapel this morning, God, may we be reminded of your faithfulness, God. May we be reminded of the gift that we celebrated this past weekend, God, the gift of your son, Father God, the gift of his death and his resurrection, God, his conquering of the grave. We just thank you, God, and we pray that you would be glorified this morning. In your name, amen.
He is Lord, Lord of
to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. In the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
He is Lord, Lord of all.
Abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. With fear they fill and fear surrounds me. You never fail, you won't start now. So I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine, Lord.
Presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters. Wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. And my faith will be made stronger presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters. Wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. And my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Oh, Lord. Oh, yeah. For you are mine, Lord. And oh, Jesus, you're my God. Ride, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. No, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave. child of God. Mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name, and I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. Now I'm no longer a slave. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of
God, and we thank you that you just love us so much. We just praise you for coming down to this earth and for sacrificing your life so that we could be free from fear. And we are just so grateful that the victory has been won and that you reign. In your name I pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. It is good to see you this morning. Thanks to the Eastern University Dance Ministry and for Precious Movements and our chapel worship team for leading us in worship this morning. We are grateful for them. And some of you I know are thinking right now, why couldn't I be in these comfortable chairs, right? But remember what the Bible says about being envious. So don't be envious this morning. We are, this is a special week in the university's life, and particularly a special chapel as we celebrate the second annual Chamberlain Interfaith Fellowship here at Eastern University. Some of you may know of the fellowship. It is an intentional Jewish-Christian interfaith partnership of shared learning and growth. And we're delighted that Raquel Block is here, who will be my conversational partner this morning. And it's a wonderful opportunity, particularly for our community, to be enriched by a deep understanding of another religion, which then helps us in our understanding of our beliefs there too. The Chamberlain Interfaith Fellowship was named after the late Dr. Ted Chamberlain, who served for nearly 30 years as Vice President for Student Development. Here's a photo of Dr. Chamberlain on the left. That's Dr. Betty Ann Brigham, Vice Provost for Student Development in the middle, and of course yours truly on the right. That's a spring banquet around in the early 2000s. If you take a look at the next picture, this is actually both of us. Both of us in the late 90s. And I do still have those glasses if you would like to see them sometime. Oh my, it's kind of a like a Starsky and Hutch or some kind of odd Miami Vice or kind of police there too. And we are grateful for Lyria Chamberlain, the widow of Dr. Ted Chamberlain, who is the fellowship is named after, to be with us this morning. So Lyria, would you please stand? We want to welcome you, that you're here, and we're grateful for that. We also have four Eastern University Chamberlain Interfaith Fellows who have applied to the fellowship, has been with the fellowship since the beginning of the academic year. We're going to ask Alberto Bonilla Giovanetti to stand up, Brooke Scott, Anthony Barr, and Jessica Nielsen has represented Eastern University. We have special friends from Temple Beth Shalom. And that is where we went, Eastern University and the fellows went in October of 2016. And we had a wonderful immersion experience with them. We're grateful to Rabbi Jay Perlman and Rachel Happel, who are at the temple, who did not travel with the group, but were instrumental in many ways of helping us have a formative experience. Rachel Block is the chaplain, so to speak. I consider you maybe the chaplain at Temple Beth Shalom, like my counterpart. And she's been a wonderful friend over the last few years. And I'm going to have her just introduce her fellows, and we'll also introduce the benefactors for this fellowship.
So thank you all so much for having us. This is my second year at Eastern, and every time I come, I'm so amazed at how beautiful your campus is and your community. So I brought with me Jacob Krieger Combs, Lily Altman, and Dora Evans from Temple Beth Shalom, and they're all high school students.
Two very special people that without them, this fellowship would not exist, is David and Sydney Feldman, who are with us from Temple Beth Shalom. David Feldman, a lifelong friend of Dr. Ted Chamberlain from their youth. They grew up together on the same block, and wonderful stories. So we're going to just ask David and Sydney to please stand this morning. And we're grateful that they're here. And last but not least, my supervisor, Dr. Betty Ann Brigham, Vice Provost for Student Development, has been instrumental in laying the foundation for conversations that occurred monthly in conference calls. So thank you, Dr. Brigham, very much for all your help there too. What we're doing here is not a typical sermon that you might, or message that you might be accustomed to, but we would thought it would be helpful for a Christian and a Jew to get together, you know?
There are a lot of jokes that start that way.
this is not a joke. This is a fellowship. But I thought it would be good to have a somewhat of a conversation which really is at the core of the fellowship, what it means to have dialogue, conversation between people with regards to different religious views, different commitments, different maybe ways of living in the world in some ways there. So Raquel, let me begin, and we have some questions we thought about, and we'll see how the conversation goes, but I wonder how many students at Eastern University has ever had a conversation with a Jewish person, I mean, a one-on-one conversation. Talk to us a little bit about maybe what stereotypes have you heard about your own religion, Judaism, particularly maybe Reformed Judaism, and maybe talk to us a little bit about that.
Great. So again, thank you all for having us. And if there's any questions that you would like to ask me over the next few days, like please feel free to come find me or any of the fellows. I'm happy to have conversations. And when we were thinking about this, I was thinking about stories. I love to tell stories. And really that the first time that I engaged with, a stereotype about Judaism, I was in fourth grade. And my family had just moved from Boston to New Mexico for a year. And none of my classmates would talk to me. And I was like, oh, I'm the new kid. I guess they don't talk to new people. And I found out that the reason why they wouldn't talk to me is because they heard that I was Jewish. Me and my brother were the only Jewish kids in our school and in the town. Like, no one had ever met anyone who was Jewish. And they all thought that I had horns. And they were really afraid to talk to me because they all thought that I had horns. And it was really challenging to be in fourth grade and not have anyone talk to you. And if you are curious where the horns thing comes from, I can tell you at another time where that stereotype comes from. But it ended up that we needed to have like a teacher intervention, that they had to come in with a rabbi, like this whole thing, because my whole class was convinced that I had horns and I had to show them my hair. No, look, really. And the next thing that happened that was really a similar situation was when I was in middle school, there was this thing that would happen that if any time somebody would pick up a coin off the ground, they would say, oh, you're a cheap Jew. And they would do this thing where actually there would be kids who would throw pennies. And if you were walking around and you happened to be a person who picked up a penny, then they would say, no matter who you were, they would say, oh, you're a penny-pinching Jew. And would go on in that regard. And the third instance that I can think about, which was really interesting, is when I was in college. I was in college in Ohio for a bit, and I was at a conference where the goal was to go around and introduce yourself, and you were really like practicing, how do you shake hands, how do you introduce yourself? And I introduced myself to somebody, and I shake their hand, and I moved my scarf, and I was wearing a Jewish star as I am now, and I moved my scarf, and the woman who shook my hand said, I can't believe you just touched me, you dirty Jew. And walked away. And that was the whole interaction. I was like, what just happened? So those are some, and I think that they kind of like speak to some of the major stereotypes about Judaism. Horns, some kind of cheap money situation, and some kind of dirty. So do you have stereotypes about your faith?
Let me just say this. One of the reasons we have the fellowship is to combat these types of stereotypes, right? When you get to know a person and begin to really share some common ground. I think for me, as I was thinking about this, I have the good fortune of teaching the New Testament here at Eastern University. And probably one of the stereotypes that students wrestle with or come in with initially is that Jesus was a Christian, right? And when I tell them he wasn't, in the formal sense, he's a Jew, right? That we believe is the risen Messiah, the one in which he's the King of the King and Lord and so forth. It begins to kind of unpack a little bit about how important is understanding Judaism in our understanding of Christianity. Another stereotype I think that I've heard that Christians are always against everything. Like we're anti this, anti that, anti this. And I guess from my perspective, I would hope that we are a community that are for things, that we're proactive in the way in which we understand Christianity, that it's good news believing in Jesus, right? It's good news embracing that relationship rather than, oh, you're a Christian, so you must be against this or against that and so forth. Those are some stereotypes. Now, stereotypes are not necessarily false all the time. Some people actually do approach their Christianity with that kind of perspective, that Jesus was a Methodist or Presbyterian, right, to kind of de-Judaize Jesus is really like, you know, we talk about keep Christ in Christmas. I'd like to keep Jesus Jewish. It would be a great bumper. I can, please don't take that idea. I might actually start selling that on the internet. Keep Jesus Jewish, because in many ways, and I mean this wholeheartedly, it really respects the deep rootedness of our understanding of Judaism, at least in the way in which we approach it. Let's see what other questions we have. No. I think one of the things we talked about is, and this is really interesting, we experienced this at Temple Beth Shalom with our fellows about the spiritual disciplines and practices within each tradition that help us stay rooted. I think sometimes Christians feel like all our traditions, like prayer, meditation, like we came up with them, right? Or like reading scripture, well, that's our thing. But people have been reading scriptures, praying, and meditating for many, many, many millennia even before Jesus. So what are some things for you as a person who's part of the Temple Beth Shalom leadership? You're in many ways a religious leader there, working with young people. How do you stay anchored, focused? You know?
So I'm very lucky. As part of my role, I teach 6th through 12th grade in a supplementary experience. And that's one of the way that I think really nourishes my spiritual practice. Talking to a very angsty 6th grader who's like, I believe in nothing, and then showing him text and him being like, whoa, that's cool. It's a really beautiful part of my day, and I'm lucky that I get to do this often. And then personally, I love Shabbat. I love Friday night services, and I have really a custom of going every Shabbat to services and experiencing it, particularly in community and the community of my peers. And I remember, again, I'm going to tell a story. As I was growing up, I had a rabbi who would say, spirituality is like a glass of water. When you're little, your glass is little and your cup is really full. As you get older, your cup gets bigger. And what are you doing to add water to your cup? And I think that's really part of my spiritual practice, is I really think about, as I get older, as I experience new different things, what am I doing to put water in my cup? Which we've talked a lot about and similar. And one of the ways that I put water in my cup is being here. And I am amazed at the connection. And the other thing that I have to mention is Lyria and I were very lucky to sit next to each other on the plane to David's sadness, because we caused a lot of trouble. But Lyria and I spent a lot of time talking about what we believe and how we see the world. And I think that really fills my spiritual cup and really, you know, being in dialogue. I think that as Jews, we're the people who struggle, Am Yisrael, the people who struggle with God. And that struggle is something that's really foundational to me, and that really working through some things that are challenging or talking about text is really important. And so any kind that I'm in those kinds of conversations, I go, amen. That just filled my cup, and it was really beautiful. So, yeah, that's what I think about.
Yeah, you know, thinking about spiritual disciplines and practices, we even have a class called The Foundations of Christian Spirituality here at the university, where a professor will talk about different disciplines. I guess for me, it's changed over time because I've changed. And, you know, being in college or seminary, graduate school, and so forth, I think for me, I'm going to use the word ritual. It's really important for me to have a sense of ritual in the way in which I stay anchored. So for my, what we would call the devotional life in Christianity, I use a prayer book that's very scripted, that tells me what I should pray on a Monday morning and what I should pray, just say, on a Monday evening to begin and close the day. So prayer books to me have really helped me stay anchored in a way that I feel connected to both God and to neighbor. I will say two other things, which is going to maybe appear odd at first, depending on which tradition you worship in, as Christians particularly. I love when I see people go up and receive the Eucharist, the bread and the cup. I mean, I go up too. I'm not just watching. I do go up, right? Where Christians would believe that is the body and blood of Christ, right? Whether it's sacramental, memorialized, but just to watch all different kinds of people walk It is so beautiful just to sit there and you see the young, the old, the tall, the short, all different people coming to the altar, the table to receive that gift, and also the passing of the peace. That's another thing that I really, really enjoy. I wouldn't say it's a spiritual discipline necessarily, but when I go to church, that's something I yearn for, looking for to be part of that. As we think about our religions, right? I mean, there's ways of understanding our religions by our differences about just say how we view Jesus of Nazareth, right? And we've had good conversations on that. But I thought a question would be interesting, Raquel, if you can tell me what keeps you Jewish or what's the most compelling thing about your religion? And I'll talk a little bit what I think is compelling about Christianity, right? There's got to be things that are compelling to keep you, so to speak, in the faith, right?
Yeah, I think there's definitely elements of like my family history, language, culture. Those things are really compelling to me. I love Hebrew. I'm a Hebrew nerd. I'm not as good as I would like to be, but I'm a nerd about it. But really, I think I go back to the Am Yisrael, where the people that struggle with God. And I think in my life, I've had some really significant struggles. And I think that it's such a beautiful thing to know this is good too. And I think about that through struggle, we grow, we gain, and that my tradition tells me that this is holy work that I'm doing. You know, these struggles that I'm going through are holy, and that this is my tradition. These are where my people come from. So I think a lot about that. And the other thing that's important to me is that throughout my life, there have been some things in which institutions or people have closed their door and said, "Oh, you're not welcome here. This part of who you are is not welcome here." And in my Jewish practice, I've always seen, you know, I'm a person who has a learning disability. I've seen in my Jewish tradition that different types of learning is not only accepted and welcome here, but a part of our tradition. And that there are different learning styles. You know, when we talk about Passover and the four children, there are different learners there. And I think that not only is it beautiful, you know, not only am I here at the table, but I'm encouraged and my tradition really welcomes me. So I find that really compelling.
Yeah, I've been thinking about what's compelling about Christianity. I go back to when I was in college in the 70s, not the 1870s, but the 1970s, that to me, what was compelling about Christianity when I was a college student in particular was the person of Jesus Christ. He became plausible. He became winsome. When I began to study scripture, particularly the gospels, he seemed like someone I could live my life according to teachings and live into a relationship. And I know in college, I was not thinking that Christianity was simply a way to take care of the afterlife. Like, okay, I'll accept Jesus, and now if I die, I know where I'm going, and then I live my life any old way. But when I embraced Jesus in college in a way that I felt was plausible and compelling, it was a way to how to live life now. It was a way to shape my life now about that. So I don't know, there might be some Christians that feel that what's the most compelling thing about their religion is that it tells you where you're going. Because I want to live as long as I can. That's the hope. That's why I take
I like that too.
Well, I take my medication, I go to the doctor, you know, I do all the things. So I hope I don't have a death complex just because I'm a Christian, right? But I will say, as many more years that I do live, I feel that Jesus and a relationship with him allows me to live this life abundantly. There's something about the way I see Jesus in the Gospels in particular that helps me live now.
Yeah. It's interesting because that's really similar to what I'm saying of like that I'm welcome here and, you know, it's really interesting that we're, not surprising, very interesting that we're in a similar place.
You've been here now. Last year, Raquel was here, and we've had many conversations via conference call and opportunities for long conversations. What are you most impressed about so far with Christianity? And I'll tell you what I think might be, what I'm really impressed with Judaism. But what's your holy envy? We talk a lot about, like, what do you appreciate, right? What do you appreciate about another religion, right? I don't know everything about Judaism, believe me. But there's some things you might appreciate about Christianity.
Yep, for sure. So I will start with that my best friend growing up went to Catholic school. So I always thought I knew a lot about Catholicism. He went to Catholic school. We would talk about religion a lot. He was wrong about everything. So every time I come to Eastern, I call him and I say, you taught me the wrong thing again. And it's really fun to get to say that to him about his own religion. But see the kind of relationship we have. But I think the thing that I have consistently walked away from is in holy envy is about the prayer space. We talk about in Judaism keva and kavana, intention and root prayer. Last night we were talking about planning as a cohort of fellows. A prayer vigil moment, and my students were like, what do you mean? We start with the Baruch Hu, we go to the Shema, then we have the Amidah, that's how you pray. And I think that when I studied liturgy about how prayers came to be, it's a scaffolding. It's not, this is the only way to do it. And when I see y'all pray and experience this is holy. I feel this. I always get excited to come to chapel here. And I want to bring back to my tradition more of that intentionality, and that we're gonna feel it and we're gonna go where our feelings take us and not be confined to what our, you know, all right, we're on page two, we gotta go to page three. So I really appreciate that about being here.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for that. I'm going to ask Anna, can you go to the slide that shows Temple Beth Shalom? Because there's some holy envy when you walk into the sanctuary. Now, Raquel, I'm going to ask you to do something. This is not scripted. Can you walk over to show where the Torah scrolls would be?
Sure.
All right. So we don't have a pointer. That's something I forgot. But when I go to Temple Beth Shalom with our fellows, where Raquel is pointing is where they keep the Torah scrolls. These are scrolls, I don't know how tall they are, but the way in which the respect of the Torah, the respect of the word, the respect of scripture is so visually, and I become envious of just the way you care for these scrolls that are opened up. They're in Hebrew. There is even a special pointer that the rabbi will use to read the text, as we would consider like a lectionary reading or a Torah portion. Just highly holy. And I'm so envious. Christians revere the Bible in many ways. We call it inspired. But I remember a student one time from another religious tradition, and I was teaching the Bible, and she came up to me and she said, Dr. Modica, I can't believe you Christians. And I said, what do you mean? She said, you have a Bible for everything. You have like teenage Bible, you have getting older Bible, children's Bible, millennial Bible, you know, you and a study Bible.
Yep.
And yeah, but in my tradition, we just have...
We got one.
And I just have holy envy of the respect and the dedication to Torah, you know, there. So I like that a lot. I really do. We are going to have an interfaith prayer service and candle lighting tonight. Why are we doing this? Well, I think it was wonderful to work with the fellows, both from Eastern University and Temple Beth Shalom, to put together something that we'll do perhaps for a half hour or 40 minutes this evening to show a call to understanding, respect, and peace. I think, I don't know about you, but if you watch any news, you might know of the increase of anti-Semitism, particularly even in our own country, but you can even take a look at globally about instances in cemeteries or putting swastikas on temples, you know, spray painting. And let me just say this, as a Christian in our Christian community, we abhor that. We oppose that. This is not what it means to be in dialogue at all or disagreement, but rather, what does it mean to have a robust religious pluralism? What does it mean to have holy envy and a deep respect for that? So we do hope, if you're available, to come out tonight to be with us, just for a time in which we'll share Jewish and Christian prayers along those topics, so that we can work together. There's a lot of work to do in this world. You can begin to see that more and more as you read the news.
I want to thank you again for having us here. We are so grateful to be here and to get to experience your lovely campus and your lovely school. And please, again, say hi. Say hi to my kids. And thank you.
We're going to ask, we're going to just pray a blessing, and we're going to close chapel. We're going to read from Numbers 6, 24 to 26. I'm going to ask the fellows and David and Sydney, if you would just come forward and stand with us. We're going to ask you to stand for the benediction as we do. Yeah, come forward. We want to, all the Eastern University fellows, Dr. Brigham, all those who have been intimately part of the fellowship, we want you to pray for us this week. And we also want to, if you're a student, we'd like you to apply to the fellowship this summer as we look for the next cohort as we begin and continue our interfaith dialogue. So let us pray. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. You are dismissed. Have a wonderful day.